Good morning, dear students. Welcome to this session. In this session, we will learn about the JavaScript. Where does it go inside your HTML document? So there are basically three ways we can link the JavaScript with the HTML page. The first one is inline. You can have it inline with the HTML tags, or we can have in the embedded style. And the third one is the external. Let us see one example for those. This is for the inline. This is a simple code. So you can see here, there is a HTML tag for the link. And inside the href, I have JavaScript colon open window. This is the function that is available with the JavaScript, and in the next it is an input button, type is button, and there is a on click event, and whenever on click or the click event happens, we have a piece of JavaScript code here that will get executed. I will run this particular code in a window. This is the link and this is the button. On for that button, on there is an on click event. On click event, we are calling the alert. Alert is nothing but which will display a window, and whatever is the text inside that alert, that will be displayed. For example, here in the alert, the text written is "Are you sure?" and question mark. This particular message will be displayed on a window. Let me click on that button, on click. So I made the click. So it will display the text that is shown here. "Are you sure?" That is what you have included in that particular alert function as a parameter. And next one is the embedded. This is the inline. This is how we are going to use. We just saw the example. That particular JavaScript will be used with inline with the HTML tag as an attribute. Next one is the embedded style. We can have JavaScript as an embedded in the header section, similar to CSS. Here we use the script, that is the tag we are going to use. We will have the opening script, open script, and the close script. And in between open and close script, we will have all the Java code. That is the place where the JavaScript code will reside. So you can see script type is equal to text or JavaScript, and this is a closing angle. In between, you have all the JavaScript code, and then we will have the closing script tag. The example we will see here. So in the head section, I have the script, and in between the script tags, I have JavaScript code. Only thing that is present here is a one alert function with the text saying "Hello world." This is what will happen. Since we have this in the head section, what will happen is when a HTML document is loaded, immediately this JavaScript gets executed, and then rest of the HTML page will load. This is the code, mb.html. You can see "Hello world," that JavaScript is executed. That alert function will work. It will display a window with the text "Hello world." I will say okay, then rest of the page is loaded. If I refresh, whenever I do reloading of this page, that particular JavaScript will get executed. And there is a third way of doing it, using an external JavaScript. In case of an external JavaScript, all the JavaScript code will reside in a one external file, and you will give a file extension as a .js. and that particular .js file you will include in the HTML document. And how to include that? Using in the header section, you have the opening script tag, then type what type of a file it is, text or a JavaScript, and source. You will give the a source file here. This is assuming that the greeting.js JavaScript file is available where you have the HTML. So it will fetch from that particular directory. If it is in some other directory, either you have to give the relative path or the absolute path. Then we have the closing script. Okay. JavaScript supports this separation by allowing links to be external file that contains the JavaScript. By convention, JavaScript external files have the extension .js. So this external JavaScript, by having this, you are segregating the JavaScript code and the HTML file. It's a good way of writing the code, where you have two distinct files for the HTML document as well as the JavaScript. Similarly, we use the CSS. CSS, the style can be included in an external file. And with the extension .css. So in that way, our HTML document is separated from the style, that is CSS file, and the JavaScript code, that is .js file. There are some advanced inclusions that are available. Generate embedded styles to reduce the request. Code still managed in the external file. So we can generate the embedded style just to reduce the request. Another is using the iframe. So we'll see that later, iframe. And asynchronous load from another JavaScript file. So we can have a JavaScript inside the another JavaScript file so that the faster, initially it will load whatever the JavaScript you are required, it will load a little faster. Then asynchronously, as and when it is required, it will load the other JavaScript files. JavaScript syntax. Here we are going to look the fundamental syntax for most of the common programming constructs that are available with a JavaScript language. So similar to any other language, whatever the languages you are learned, C, Java, Python, it has all those kinds of a construct. Maybe a little bit variation, but most of the constructs are available. What are the constructs that we are going to see is variables, how to do the assignments, conditional statements, how the conditional statements can be included in JavaScript code. Then looping, how to provide the looping arrays. And these are the basic things we are going to look. And there are more advanced topics in JavaScript language, such as events and the classes. JavaScript's reputation for being quirky not only stems from the strange way of implementing object-oriented principle, but also from some odd syntactic gotchas. So some of the implementation that is done in case of a JavaScript implementation of the object-oriented, it might be a little different, so it might look strange. And there are certain other things which makes it as a little different, such as one thing is Java is a case sensitive language. So everything is type or case sensitive, including function, classes, and variable names. Suppose if you have a variable called length, okay, with all lowercase, that variable, and another variable, same name, length, but in an uppercase or some init cap, all those three variations will be considered as three different variables. So JavaScript language is a case sensitive. And that it is not only true for the variable, it is true for functions, classes, and all other variables. And one more thing about the scope of the variables. In case of a variables, the block scope, okay, is not supported. The scope of variables in blocks is not supported. Means the visibility of the variable not is restricted by the block. unlike some other languages. This means variables declared inside a loop may be accessible outside of the loop, counter to what one would expect. So normally, so far whatever the languages we have seen, if we have declared any loops inside a certain loop, its scope is only that loop. When it comes out of the loop, that particular variable loses the visibility. But in case of a Java script language, the visibility goes beyond that. So because there is no support for that, such a kind of a block scope. And there is a operator which is like a three equal signs together. Three equal signs together, it makes an operator which says not only the equality but a type equivalence. So what it will check, if it is a number, it will check for the numerical equality, and also it will check the type, whether the type of this left hand variable and the right hand variable is same or not. Means if it is a number, whether this is also number or not, that check, it checks for both equality of a type as well as the equivalence of the type. It will check both. In case of JavaScript languages, null and undefined, these are two distinctly different states of for a variable. So these are two different. Null is different and undefined is different. These are two different states. Semicolons are not required. It is not mandatory, but it is encouraged to have. It is good to have the semicolon, but it is not required. There is no integer type, only a number, which means floating point rounding errors are prevalent even with the values intended to be integers. So the integer type is it's only a number, so floating point rounding errors are more frequent, and that has to be taken into consideration. So first thing is a variable. So we know what is a variable. Variable is the one which can hold the value. Okay, it can hold a value temporarily, and the value that is held in particular variable can be changed at a different stage of a program. Variables in JavaScript are dynamically typed, meaning variable can be integer and then later string, then later an object if so desired. So in case of C programming or a Java programming, once we declare the variable, we give a certain type. Okay, what type, whether it is an integer, whether it's a character, whether it's a floating point. In case of a JavaScript, it is dynamically typed, means you will not specify what type. So that particular variable can take a number, later it can take a text, and so on. Actually, this helps the programmers. This simplifies variable declaration so that we do not require the familiar type fields like int, char, and string. Instead, we just use var. This is a keyword that we use for declaring the variables in JavaScript language. Assignment can happen at the declaration time by appending the value to the declaration, or at runtime by assigning some value. This is very similar to other language. Either assignment can be done at the stage when you are declaring a variable, with equal sign you can give the value, or you just declare the variable and later when you are using any kind of a processing, dynamically you can assign the value to those particular variables. This is the example. So this is the variable declaration. X is the variable. Just you will say the keyword var space x and semicolon. This particular variable x will be declared. This is both declaration and initialization, both done in a same statement. You will say var, that is the keyword, name of the variable equals whatever the value want to initialize, followed by the semicolon. What it will do, it will declare a variable called y and it will assign it with the value of 0. Then if you just do the declaration, later at any stage you can assign the value, which is same as other languages. Y is equal to 4. Here the value of 4 is assigned to the variable y. This is a conditional statement. We have seen the conditional statement, question mark, and a colon. Basically what this will do is, this is a, you will assign a value, and on the right hand side this particular conditional statement is evaluated. How this conditional statement is evaluated? First we will check the condition. Okay, until the question mark it is the condition, after the question mark and until the semicolon it is the true value. If this condition is a true, this value is used for the assignment. If this condition is false, after the colon and before the semicolon, whatever the value is there, that is the false, that particular value is assigned. So in this case, if y value is 4, that condition is a true, then x will have a value y is 4. So it is a text, it will have a text y is 4. And if this condition is false, x will be assigned with the value, the text value y is not 4. Comparison operators. So there are many comparison operators that are available in the JavaScript language. Equality, this checks whether the left hand side and the right hand side variables are equal or not. It can be variables or it can be constant. In this example, x is equal to 9. If original value x is assigned with the value of 9, x equals 9, you get it as a true. Next condition you can see here, you have to be very careful here when you are using just double equal signs, that is used for the equality. The right hand side number is it's a constant number 9, and left hand side it is assigned with the number 9. So 9 is equal to 9, this is true. Now x is assigned with the number 9, but what you are comparing with, you are comparing with a text, that is a text 9. Here also it will give a answer as true, because it is not checking the type. If we had used three equal signs, which will check both the content as well as the type, what will happen in that particular case? If I use x, a triple equal sign, that is the operator, and give the text on the right hand side, the answer is false. Why it is false? On the right hand side the content is 9, but it is text. On the left hand side the variable content is 9, but it is a number. The type, there is a mismatch in the type, that is why it gives the false. And next one gives true. Why it is true? The left hand side content and content is 9, type is number. Right hand side content is 9 and it is a number. Both type and the content are matching, that's why it will give the true. Then it is less than greater than, which is you have commonly used, less than equal to, greater than equal to. This is not equal and not equal double sign. So here that variation, type variation, you will see here also. Not equal is exclamation symbol and equal. 4 not equal to x is true. So because x is what? 9. 4 not equal to 9, this is true. When you are using double equal, it will check both the type as well as the value. If you are using just exclamation and equal, it will just look for the content. So if you are using exclamation, a double equal sign, then see, this particular answer gave as a true and this gave as a false. Now what is the content of x? It is 9. Even though 9, this content are same, but the type is different, isn't it? This is a integer and a right hand it is a text. So integer not equal to text, that is why you are getting the answer true. Either content is not equal or the type is not equal, you will get the true. The next one, x exclamation equal equal 9, this will result in false. Why it is false? X, the type is integer, and the right hand side the type is integer, here content is 9, here content is 9. So both are not matching. That's why it will give the answer as false. Logical operators. We know the logical operators. Okay, the Boolean operators AND or NOT and their truth tables are listed here. Syntactically, they are represented with AND is represented with two ampersand signs which are used together, and OR is represented with two pipe signs. So pipe is like a vertical bar, you can say, and NOT is exclamation. And the truth table for AND is exactly same as the operators, logical operators that are used in another language. True and true is always true. Okay, as long as both are true, or you can say if one of the entity is false, then result is false. If both are true, then only it is true. In case of OR, even if one entity is true, this or that, if one entity is true, the result of OR operation on both these variables will result in true. So you can see here, in first three conditions, one of the value, either A or B, is true, that's why output is true. In the last condition, both are false, that's why A or B, you get the false. And in case of a NOT, it's a like you can say complement, true will becomes false, false will become true. So and it's a unary operator. Conditionals, we have same if else if statements that can be used in JavaScript language. JavaScript syntax is almost identical to the that of PHP, Java or C when it comes to conditional structures such as if and if else statement. In this syntax, the condition to test the that is contained within the round brackets, the condition. So round brackets will hold the condition, and the body is identified, the body block is identified by the opening curly brace and the closing curly brace, which is exactly similar to the C or other languages. This is the example. Two variables are defined, variable var keyword, hour of day, then another variable greeting. If hour of day is greater than 4 and hour of day less than 12. So it is hour of day is greater than 4 and hour of day is less than 12. Greeting, good morning. So just you are identifying what time it is. So accordingly you can greet. Then if hour of day is greater than 12 and hour of day is less than 20. 20 is nothing but 8 o'clock in the night. You will say good afternoon, and anything other than this, you will say good evening. So you have to basically focus on the if else structure. So if in the bracket we have the condition, then this is the true block, okay, and this one is the else if. So when you use just else, there will be false block. If you use else if, so it will, this condition will be checked. If this condition is false, it will come here. Else if will pose another condition here. This condition will be checked. If this condition is true, then this is the true block, opening curly brace and closing curly brace. If this condition is also false, then it will come to the this else block. And else block, this is the opening block, opening curly brace, and this is the closing curly brace. Then loops. Loops are also exactly similar to other languages. And in case of a loops, whatever the condition you want to put, that is put inside the round brackets, and the block of the code is put inside the curly or the flower brackets. You will encounter the while and the for loops. JavaScript supports while as well as the for loop. while loops normally initialize the loop control variable before loop uses the condition and modify within the loop. So in case of while, if you are using any kind of a variable, you will do the initialization. First, you will do the initialization variable declaration as well as initialization I is equal to 0. And here is the condition I less than 10. That is the condition. And this is the block of the code, opening curly brace and closing curly brace. Inside, just we are increment the value of I plus plus. So this loop will work as long as this I will initially starts from 0. And when it reaches the value of 10, 10 less than 10 is the false condition, then it will come out of the loop. For loops, very similar structure. Here, for loop combines the common component of a loop, initialization, condition, post loop operation into one statement. So, initialization and condition and post loop. Once the one loop is complete, what will be done? All these things into one that we already know from other languages. The construct of a for loop is exactly the same. This statement begins with a for keyword and has the components placed between brackets. Okay, that is initialization, condition, and post loop operation will be inside the round brackets and brackets, semicolon, separated by semicolon as shown. You have variable initialization I is equal to 0, then we separate by semicolon, then the condition I less than 10, we separate the condition from this post loop operation I plus plus. So this is do something, this is the code of the block. So inside the curly braces you will have whatever the code you want to put in, you can put it in there, which will loop as long as this condition is true. Functions. Functions are the similar to other languages like C. Okay. Functions are the building block for modular code in JavaScript. What you mean by modular code? Instead of having one big piece of a code, you can modularize that one. You can take out the chunks which are common and you make it as a separate function and you maintain it as a separate function. So the code is very modular, easy to understand, easy to maintain, and are even used to build pseudo classes, which you will learn about later. So which can be used, functions can be used to build pseudo classes also. We'll see that one later. They are defined by using the reserved word function. So function, and it is a key sensitive, okay? It is a case sensitive, means whenever you are using a variable name, whatever the name you are using, that is case sensitive. As I told you before, if you are creating an add function, let's say you have function name as add, lowercase all, ADD, or if you have another function, capital A, DD, both will be considered as a different function because it is case sensitive. So you will have a function keyword, then you will followed by a function name, and parameters are optional. If you are passing any parameter, you can specify, otherwise it is optional. What it requires is a keyword, function, and the name of the function. Since JavaScript is dynamically typed, function do not require return type, nor do the parameters require the type. So one good thing about the functions in JavaScript, you need not specify the return type, what type of a data the function will return. And also you need not specify what is the type of the parameters that you are passing. This is the example. In this particular example, a function is created to raise x to the yth power, x raised to y, means you will multiply x y times. Okay, that is the function, functionality of this particular function. You will specify the keyword function space name of the function. So what is the name you are given? Power, all in lower case, bracket, okay, round bracket. In this case, you have to send two parameters, x comma y. Notice there is no return type and we did not specify the type of x and y. And inside the function, the function will start, function body will start here, and it will end here. What we have, we are creating one more temporary variable inside the function, var variable, pow is equal to 1. Then what we are doing, for variable I is equal to 0, I less than y, I plus plus, basically we are having this particular loop run for these many y times. Suppose y value is 5, this loop will run 5 times. And what we are doing inside, POW is equal to POW into x, whatever the this value, POW initially is 1. Let us say this value is 4 and this is 5, 1 into 4, okay, that value will be stored in POW. In the next loop, 4 into 4, 16 will be stored, next 16 into 4 and so on. So what it will do, it will multiply this particular x value y times, and result will be stored in the POW. And once this exits, after y times the loop is completed, it will come out of the loop, you are returning the POW. So that value is stored in POW, you are returning. This is how you will declare the function in the JavaScript. And how to call, very similar to other languages, you will say, you will assign this value to some variable, you will say z is equal to power 2 comma 10. So 2 will be multiplied by 2 will be multiplied 10 times, and whatever the value will be returned. That alert we already saw in one example. Alert function makes the browser to show a pop-up to the user with whatever is passed being the message displayed. So this will just give a pop-up window, and whatever the content you include as a parameter, that will be displayed in that particular message. Using alerts can get tedious fast. When using debugger tools in your browser, you can write output to a log. Okay, suppose if you want to do normally when we do the alert, suppose you want to do a debugging, so somewhere you are getting the error, you don't know where you are getting, so you use the alert in between. So you can alert the values, okay, you can display the values, or you can display the plain text, so at various stages, so that you will come to know how the flow and where it is breaking. That is one way to do, but it is gets very tedious. The other way to do it is debug is we can use the console. We can write the output of whatever values, intermediate values, into particular log file. So we can say console.log, and we can put the message or values of the variables, whatever you information that will help you in debugging, that particular values can be put inside that particular log. And later you can use the debugger to access this log. And you will see inside the log, you will see all the messages, and you will come to know what was the flow and where it got interrupted. That is how you can debug the code. Errors using the try and catch. So exception handling, you have already studied in the Java. This works very similar to that. When browsers, a JavaScript engine encounters any kind of an error, it will throw an exception. If there are any kind of an error, let us say you are trying to open a file and that file is not present, that's an error. A file is corrupted, that's another kind of error. Such situations will result in an error. So you can catch that error, and we can handle using the try and catch block. These exceptions interrupt the regular sequential execution of the program and can stop the JavaScript engine altogether. However, you can optionally catch these errors, preventing disruption of program using try and catch block. So any such errors which you anticipate, you can catch them. Okay, because once these errors happen, programming it will be sequential execution of the program will stop at that point, and it will come out. Okay, so we can use a try and catch block. When we use the try and catch block, the code will execute sequentially. If there is any error, then directly the catch block will catch that particular error, and we can display the kind of a error what it is causing the error. Here you can see try. This is the open curly brace and closing. This is the try block. Whatever is in the try block, if error occurs in that code, it will be caught. Okay, it will be caught in the catch block. If there are any kind of error, right now we have, what we have is a non-existent function. So some function is there and its implementation is somewhere. We don't know the implementation. Maybe it is a 1000-line code or a 100-line code. That whole code is inside the try block. If there is any kind of an error, that error will be caught. Then what you are doing, once you catch it, alert an exception was caught plus ERR. So ERR is the actual error that is caught, and you are just appending with some kind of a text. An exception was caught, this is the text, plus basically it will work as a concatenation. It will concatenate the whatever is in the error object and it will display the message. One is like JavaScript, whenever it encounters the error, it will throw the error. The other way is you can throw your own. Okay, there is a provision, you can throw your own exceptions. Although try and try catch can be used exclusively to catch the built-in JavaScript errors, it can also be used by your program to throw your own messages. The throw keyword stops normal execution, sequential execution, just like the built-in ones. This is the example. We have try block and we have some variable. X is equal to minus 1. Here we are setting the value. Let us say you are reading this particular value from the user input. Okay, then it, this value will be given dynamically. In this particular example, they have just shown X is equal to minus 1. Let us say this X value is coming from the form element. User is inputting that value and we are doing the validation. If X is less than 0, if this value is less than 0, what we will do is we can throw. From try block, this is a user defined throw. I will say throw, and I will the text that is given for that throw is smaller than zero error. This error will be caught by the catch block. Okay, and once it catches this error, then it will execute the catch block. Then what it will do, it will alert. Alert means it will show up a pop-up window and it will display smaller than zero error was thrown. So it is a concatenation of this, and this will be displayed onto that particular pop-up. So how to use the try and catch? Some of the tips are here. Try catch and throw statement should be used for abnormal or exceptional cases in your program. If there are any abnormal or exceptional cases, then only you should use the try catch throw statements. Throwing an exception disrupts the sequential execution of a program. We already understand whenever you throw an exception, whatever sequential execution, that will get stopped and it will come out. Okay, when an exception is thrown, all subsequent code is not executed until the catch statement is reached. So whatever, once there is a either there is a error, system error, and we are getting some kind of a error, or there is a user throw, either system throw or a user throw, from that particular point, rest of the code is not executed. It will directly go to the catch block. This reinforces why try catch for exceptional cases. So why? Because there is certain portion of the code is not executed. That's why we should use this in the exceptional cases. The next class, we will look into the JavaScript objects. Thank you.